Hello everyone, I'm Jacob Kaufman, I'm Nerd in the Street, and this is my full review of the LG G2. So about a year and a half ago, I got this LG G2 for Christmas, and I immediately made a video about it. My long-term subscribers might remember that, my initial impressions video about the G2. And last week, I actually broke the screen on this thing, and I just got it fixed yesterday. But breaking the screen and having to use another phone for a week made me realize how much I like this phone. This is a really, really nice phone, and I wanted to go into more detail about it, about why I like it, than I did in that initial impressions video a year and a half ago. So yeah, here we are today. This is my full review of the G2. The G2 was LG's flagship phone in 2013. Last year, in 2014, LG released the LG G3, and this year, 2015, they just released the G4, or they're about to. I think it's on pre-order right now, and it's going to be shipping next month. So this is not a new phone anymore. However, I am always surprised at how well it stacks up against new phones. So just to run through some of the specs. Alright, well, I actually have no idea what processor it has, and that's a good thing because it means that I've never had any problems with the processor. I do know that it has 2 GB of RAM, which is a lot. It was a lot for a device a year and a half ago, and it's still a decent amount today for an Android phone. It's got a 3,000 milliamp hour battery, which once again, 3,000 milliamp hours was a big battery for a year and a half ago, and that's still a big battery today. A lot of the flagship phones today from Samsung and HTC don't have batteries as big as the one in this phone. So the first thing I have to say about this phone is it lasts forever on a single battery charge. I consistently get 2 days worth of battery out of this, and I use my phone quite a bit. I use it for checking email. In fact, I very rarely check my nerdonthestreet.com email on my computer. Usually I check it through my phone because I've got the CyanogenMod email app set up to receive emails for jacob@nerdonthestreet.com. So if you email me there and I respond, that's happening on this device. But I also, you know, check my regular Gmail on here. I watch YouTube on here. Sometimes I watch Netflix on here. I do a lot of Google searches on here. Obviously it's an Android device, so I'm going to be using Google services. I use navigation a lot now that I'm driving. I use the Maps app that reads the directions out loud to you so you don't have to look at it. So yeah, I use this thing a decent amount and I always get 2 days of battery out of it. And I actually don't plug it in every other night on purpose, just because I've heard that it might increase your battery's lifetime if you don't charge it when it's not necessary. So I leave it unplugged every other night and I let it run down. So yeah, I plug it in every other night. And even on the days that I forget to plug it in, I can still turn it off during the school day and be able to turn it on and make a phone call after school, as I sometimes have to do because I don't have a parking spot at school right now, so I have to call people to pick me up. So yeah, battery life is the biggest, probably the best thing about this phone. I'm not sure if the LG G4 even has a battery as big as the battery in this phone. And I know that there's a lot of software things you can do to try and increase your battery life, but the number one thing you can do to increase your battery life is have a bigger battery, and this phone has a really big battery. Aside from the battery, the rest of the phone also has very nice hardware. I'll hold it up to the camera so you can see it. The front is almost entirely the screen, and one of the most eye-catching things about the screen is the bezels on the left and right side. If I turn the screen on, you can see there. Why don't I go ahead and unlock it? And look at how small the bezels on the sides are. That's something when you look at the box of this phone and you see the picture of the phone, it almost looks photoshopped. But when you hold one in your hand and you actually see it for the first time, it is amazing. You know, most phones have fairly large bezels, but on the sides there, now it's the top and bottom because I turned it. Yeah, almost no bezel. And some people don't actually like that. It depends on really how you hold your phone and how big your hands are. Some people worry about, since the bezels are so small, accidentally touching the screen, or accidentally swiping or doing things when you're just trying to hold the phone like this. I know that LG's built-in software has, something in the software that if you're holding the phone, it's kind of awkward to do it while I'm facing the camera away from me, but if I kind of turn around here, LG's built-in software has a function that tries to minimize accidental presses like I'm doing right now. You can see in CyanogenMod, we don't have those functions, so I'm holding my thumb near the side of the device, and it is dragging things around on the screen there. You can maybe see. If you can't see, just take my word for it for now. LG, like I said, they have built into their software for this phone, their ROM, a feature that basically tries to minimize accidental clicks. But using CyanogenMod, and I'll talk about that a little bit later, why I put CyanogenMod on it. But using CyanogenMod, I have not had any problems really with accidental clicks. I hold the phone normally like this in my hand. So yeah, I don't really have any part of my hand touching either side of the device. And then of course, if you're holding it in landscape, if you're playing a game or something, you can easily hold it. There's plenty of bezel at the top and bottom of the phone, so you can, you know, put your thumbs there and do whatever. If you're playing a racing game, I don't know if you guys play games on your phones. I used to, but I don't anymore. But yeah, that screen is a 1080p screen, and 1080p is kind of on its way out now because all the phones have 4K screens, but you don't need a 4K screen on a smartphone. Now, if it was like 720p, that would not be up to code for a good screen, but this is a 1080p HD screen. And so you can watch videos in HD, you can watch them in 1080p, you can play games in 1080p, and just all of the UI and everything is 1080p, and you'll actually see on the screen in a little bit. I'm going to have some screen recording of this, so you'll see just how sharp all of the images and the text and everything on this phone is. But yeah, 1080p screen, it's like 5.3 inches or something like that. So yeah, very, very sharp screen. Now, if you're looking at this phone, like I said, I actually cracked the screen last week, and that's the first time I've ever accidentally cracked a screen on any of my devices, and I always laugh at people like, oh, how do you crack a screen on your phone? Come on. And then I was talking on the phone, as you sometimes do with your phone, and I dropped it in this basement, and there was a brick laying on the floor. There's all kinds of crap in this basement, and it just happened to land on the brick. So yeah, I did get the screen replaced last week. So if you notice that when you touch the screen in certain places, you get some distortion, that did not happen with the stock screen. That is a result of the repair job. But really, that's not even very noticeable. I'm pretty happy with the repair job. I went to Communication Depot. It's a place in St. Louis. So if you're in or around the St. Louis area and you have a phone with a cracked screen or anything that you need repaired, you know, your carrier's not gonna give a crap if you break your device. They're gonna say, well, you're in a contract, so you have to keep the device. And of course, LG is not going to replace my phone just because I dropped it. And they don't actually service these anymore. LG doesn't service these. At least if they do, then it's, you know, that's more trouble than it's worth. You have to mail it in. I'll put the website for Communication Depot. It's like STL Phones or something. I'll put the website in the description below. Huge shout out to them. Yeah, they're a smaller business. There's some more mainstream businesses in the area that were trying to charge a lot more, and that had a lot longer wait times to order the screen and everything. Communication Depot just had the screen in stock, and I just went in. It took about an hour for them to replace it, and I was out with a fixed phone. But yeah, if you notice the glue on the bottom of the device, obviously LG does not ship devices with glue on the bottom of them. That would be the repair job. But yeah, aside from that wonderful, wonderful screen, like I said, we also have a earpiece speaker at the top in the center. We've got a camera, the top right, and that camera is a 1080p camera, 30 frames per second, 1080p. So that's very good if you record front-facing video. If you take a lot of selfies, obviously, then you can use the front camera for that. But as a YouTuber, I don't personally do vlogs, but a lot of YouTubers do make vlogs, and a lot of them walk around with full-size cameras. Because smartphone front-facing cameras usually aren't very good. You know, the front camera on the iPhone is 720p. It's not full 1080p HD. The front camera on this is 1080p, so you can be walking around just out and about with this phone pointed toward you, and yeah, record 1080p video. And I have recorded a couple of video intros for the channel using that front camera, because it's just easier to see you know, am I in frame? Is everything behind me all right when you're using the front camera than it is when you're using the back camera. Speaking of the back camera, though, it is right above the buttons. It is also 1080p, but it is 1080p 60 frames per second. Now, since I have CyanogenMod, the CyanogenMod camera does not actually recognize that it's 60 FPS. So I have always just used this camera in 30 FPS because, like I said earlier, I installed CyanogenMod the day after I got this phone and I have not looked back. But you do lose some special functionalities, such as that 60 FPS video. I'm sure there's a way to hack it and get it back, but I just never put the time into it because most of my videos are 30 frames per second, or they have been in the past. Now that I've got an excellent camera, I can afford to do 60 FPS video, and now that I've got a better cooling system in my computer, I can render 60 FPS video for the channel. But yeah, I've always just used this in 30 FPS mode, but it can record in 60 frames per second, 1080p. It's got an LED for the flash right there. Hopefully you can see this. This is going to be a 4K video, so you, even though I'm holding this, you know, from way back here, you should be able to see this in decent clarity. Now, the back of the phone is plastic, and it's got sort of a, not a texture to it at all. It's pretty smooth. In fact, it's a little slick. But I can actually, I've got a microfiber cloth here that I use to just wipe this off every now and then. And if I wipe off the smudges, you can see these aren't smudges, but after having this for a year and a half, the back is getting a little scuffed up. Not sure how well you can see that, but just the top, just the corners of it, basically, the corners of the device are getting a little scuffed up, which I would have expected, like, the center to get scuffed up, but it's really not the center, it's just the corners are getting it looks like they're scuffed. I honestly don't know how else to explain what it looks like. It's not really scratched up, and it's plastic, so it's not, like, dented or anything. But yeah, there's a little wear on the back of the device. I've had it for a year and a half, like I said, though, and that barely, I can tell the difference in feel a little bit. But really, it barely makes a difference when you're holding the phone. You're not looking at the back of the phone all the time. And it doesn't even, you might or might not be able to see it in the video. So the phone holds up very well. Even though the back is plastic, a lot of premium phones have metal backs. This plastic back is still really, really nice. Might be a little slippery. You might want to get a case. Most of the G2 cases have a nice grip to them. That's because the back is slick by default, unless you have really oily hands. Now my fingers actually are oily enough to where they kind of grip onto the plastic back. It's not the ideal way to have a grip on your phone, the oil in your fingers, but you know, it works. I don't drop it often, but I could see if you hold it like this, where your fingers aren't touching the back, then it slides around a little bit because the back is plastic. Very tapered. The back is completely tapered pretty much on the left and right sides. Nothing on the left and right sides, except on the left side of the phone, there's a SIM card tray, and if you stick a little tool, they give you a tool in the box for the G2. It's smaller than a paperclip. A regular paperclip will not work, but they give you a little tool to pop the SIM tray out, and a little tray comes out, and you can place the SIM card in there and pop it back in. Not sure if you can see the crease for the SIM tray or anything. I know I said in my first impressions video that the back does not come off. People have figured out in the past year that the back, in fact, does come off if you open the SIM tray and then apply upward pressure, which I wasn't going to do myself just without knowing that. But now that I know, if I wanted to take the back off, I could do that. The battery does come out. Actually, I'm not sure if the battery comes out. I'll bet it does. There's no SD card slot in it. But yeah, like I said, you don't need to replace the battery because it's a huge battery. The SD card thing, I kind of do wish it had expandable storage just so that I could carry around multiple SD cards and not have to worry about running out of space on the phone if I'm recording things at an event or something. Let me go ahead and check how much storage is in this thing, because I actually have forgotten since I stopped using this for a camera about 6 months ago when I got a real camera. This phone has, all right, it's a 32 gigabyte, I guess it's a 32 gigabyte phone. Android is on it, and that's taking up 8 gigs, which seems like a lot. But yeah, the total available space is 24 gigabytes, so it must be a 32 gigabyte model. Like I said, I used to use this. This used to be the main camera for the channel for a while. So it certainly is enough storage to record a decent amount of video with. On the bottom of the phone, there is a micro USB port in the middle that you can plug into your computer and get files off, or you can plug into a wall to charge. It charges through the computer too. On the left side of the phone, I'm turning it all about, I can't keep track of which side is which. The left side of the phone has a headphone jack, and then there are two speaker grills in the bottom. Now, the right speaker grill is the actual speaker, and then the left speaker grill is not actually a speaker grill, but it's a microphone grill. So I should have just called it a microphone grill. If you notice the little crack in the band around it, there's like a metal band that goes around the phone that helps a little bit for gripping it. If you notice in the bottom, you can kind of see if I'm holding it on the side, you can see where the band is on the side. On the bottom, there's a little line. And if you notice that was not there before I got this replaced. So once again, this phone actually looks worse, much worse than it did when it came out of the box and when I used it for a year and a half before I got it fixed. It's just since they popped the screen off and they weren't like certified people to do that. They weren't LG employees. They weren't machines. They were just humans popping the screen off and replacing it. That's going to add some scuffs and things, but it still looks really nice even after that third party screen repair. But yeah, it looks absolutely beautiful now, and it looked even better before the third-party screen repair. So as long as you don't crack the screen like I did, then you should be good to go. And even if you do, you know, like I said, get it repaired, it still looks wonderful. Very nice phone. It's very thin. It's pretty light. There is enough weight to it to where, I don't know, I like a little weight in my devices. But yeah, it's easy to grip. Very, very thin. You can see how thin it is there. And, the elephant in the room, the buttons on the back, of course, how could I forget? One of the features of the LG G line is the buttons on the back. And, there's just three buttons, you can see. Oh, bumps the microphone there. In the middle, that silver button is the power button, so you click that to turn the power off. I'm trying to show that I'm clicking it. I'm just going to trust that the camera's picking this all up, because I'm looking at this tiny viewfinder, but it's a 4K camera. You can see what I'm doing. So above the power button, there is a volume up button, and then below the power button, there's a volume down button. So yeah, just your three standard Android buttons, power, volume up, and volume down. And some people like that, and some people don't. Personally, I love it. I enjoy using the phone. That kind of draws attention to it, the buttons being on the back. When I hand people my phone and when they ask to borrow my phone, hey, can I borrow your phone? Oh, sure. And then they feel around for 10 seconds trying to figure out where all the buttons are, and I say, oh, they're on the back. So it certainly draws attention to the phone that the buttons are on the back. But just using it day to day, I've gotten used to it. Like I said, I hold the phone like this. My pinky goes underneath it to stabilize, you know, hold it up in the air. I've got two fingers on the left side, and a thumb on the right side, and then my pointer fingers on the back resting on that button. This is how I hold my phone. When I'm checking email, I hold it, you know, like this. Sometimes my finger moves down a little bit away from the buttons, but this is how I use my phone. Holding it like this. So yeah, obviously if you're using a device for the first time, that's going to be a little strange. So if you pick this device up in the store and you're not quite sure about if you're going to be able to get used to that or not, you can use your own judgment if you're going to be able to get used to that or not. But I would highly recommend giving it the benefit of the doubt, the back buttons, because they were really easy to get used to for me. And yeah, it really makes the phone look even nicer, the fact that there's no buttons on any of the sides. This is just it's a beautiful phone. Really well-built phone. So that is the hardware. To sum it up, great battery, decent cameras, and absolutely beautiful design. And all three of those things, like I said, those three things held true a year and a half ago when I got this. They still hold true today. compared to the devices coming out today, this is still wonderful hardware. This still looks really nice compared to devices that are coming out today. So yeah, it certainly has kept its value over time, kept much of its value over time. Now let's go ahead and take a look at the software. So we are now recording the screen on this phone, and you can now see the home screen. So like I said, I am not running the stock LG software on this. I am running CyanogenMod 11 now, or is it 12? Hang on. It is. Let's go to About Phone. You can see it straight from the source. CyanogenMod 12. And this is a nightly. Now, in my first impressions video, I said I installed CyanogenMod 10. Or was it 11? I think it was CyanogenMod 10 that I originally installed. And whatever it was stable. It was a stable build of CyanogenMod. And I said, I'm not going to go to nightlies because this is my daily driver. This is the phone I have to use every day. It needs to be reliable. So I only want to install stable software on it. Well, after Lollipop came out, I really, really wanted to try Android L, Android 5.0 Lollipop. And it is absolutely gorgeous. I had some mixed feelings about Lollipop when it first came out. And yeah, I think that it works really well. I like material design. I like how it all looks and how it all acts. It's certainly different from Holo, from older versions of Android. And I certainly have nothing against Holo. If I had to go back to Android 4.4 or whatever it was before I had this, if I had to go back to Android version 4, I would be fine with it because it worked just fine for what I use this phone for every day. But yeah, Android 5.0 looks really nice. It's very, very smooth. All of the animations. I was a bit concerned about the animations because the animations on my Nexus 7, the 2012 Nexus 7, they were pretty good, but they were a little slow. But yeah, the animations on this thing, everything just flies, if you can't tell. And if there is any lag, that's only because of the screen recording. Obviously, this is going to be lagging a little bit because of that screen recording. But yeah, I have customized this. Obviously, I've put, you know, custom icon arrangements and everything. And customized some of the animations. But yeah, you can get a feel for Android 5.0 on this device. Now, when I got this device, like I said, I can't actually tell you how good the LG software is because I replaced it almost immediately. That's not because the LG software is bad. I did find the LG software to be a little bit bloated. It had a lot of features that I didn't see myself using. If you get this device, I would highly recommend putting CyanogenMod on it. And here's why. The Google Nexus 5, which was a flagship Android phone, was based off of the LG G2. It was based off of this phone. It had the buttons move back to the sides because that's a little too radical for Google to endorse. But yeah, aside from the button placement, the size, the dimensions, the specs, the Nexus 5 was pretty much the LG G2. So using the LG G2 with CyanogenMod gives me the impression that I'm using a Nexus. And that is great because the Nexus is supposed to be the best you can get out of Android devices. And I feel like this is the best you can get out of Android devices. It's stock Android, no bloatware on top of it. Yeah, a lot of customizability. You know, you can customize all your quick settings and everything. Obviously, you can upgrade faster because Lollipop was available for this phone before the LG builds were out. I could get Lollipop through CyanogenMod. So yeah, really, really good. I'm wondering what icon is missing in the bottom left there because I know that that's not always missing. What would that be? Oh, Telegram, that's what. Let's put that there. Alright, there's my home screen. So, as you can tell, I'm using the stock CyanogenMod messaging app, and I'll probably have to cover a lot of this up, so I won't scroll too much. But yeah, stock CyanogenMod messaging app with the material design stuff, you know. Yeah. You have different colors for everyone. Kirsten is orange for some reason. And yeah, the stock keyboard is on here, so it's got some autocomplete features. Obviously, you need to start typing a sentence before you're supposed to use that, but just typing in general. Typing is... I am horrible at multitasking, that's why this video is not going very well right now. But yeah, typing is a pretty good experience. You can see typing is pretty... good. I did have to get used to the Android 5.0 keyboard. That's definitely one of the things that I had to get used to. It was not an immediately pick it up thing. I didn't like it at first, but I've gotten accustomed to it now. coming from the Android 4.4 keyboard. But yeah, the stock keyboard is on here. I'm using Telegram, as you can see, and I use Telegram to talk to everyone in Nerd on the Street, and it told me that it's just been upgraded. So yeah, if you don't know, Telegram is a multi-platform messaging app, and it's more secure than SMS, and also I can access it from my computer. But yeah, there's that. There's the dialer. The dialer's weird because there's not actually a dialer anywhere in the dialer. There's speed dial, recent calls, and contacts. And if you want to just type a phone number, you have to click this floating button in the bottom of the screen. And I don't like that the button's floating. I didn't like that the button was floating. It's like I said, when you upgrade your software, you know, when you upgrade from Windows 7 to Windows 8, there's a lot of things that change and there's things you have to get used to. When you upgrade from GNOME 2 to GNOME 3, big change, there's a lot of things to get used to. And when you upgrade from Android 4.4 to Android 5.0, a lot of things to get used to. But yeah, I'm slowly coming to enjoy most of the Android 5.0 features. You can see we've got Google integration in the top, and I can tap the microphone button to immediately start searching, and it will parse my voice in real time. Won't be 100% accurate. Oh, it was 100% accurate. So yeah, we've got the Google app. Now, I actually don't use Google on my desktop computer. I use a couple of other search engines that are supposed to be more secure than Google and more private than Google, because, you know, Google records all your searches and tracks it, ties it to your IP address, ties it to your Google account, and they use that, they sell it to advertisers, and they give it to the government. So I don't actually use Google by choice. I don't use it on my computer. But since this is an Android phone, Google makes Android, I tried the DuckDuckGo app for Android. I tried the Start Page app for Android, but there's really no substitute on Android for Google. Google's just tied into so many things. You gotta just suck it up and use Google when you're using your phone. And if you're searching anything questionable, then just switch to your desktop computer. A moment ago, you might have seen the new multitasking setup. So we can go there. This is one thing that I don't quite like. I haven't quite gotten used to this yet compared to Android 4.4 had a two-dimensional, just a list of apps that you could view and scroll through and switch between. And then Android 5.0 has this like Rolodex type thing. And I mean, it's kind of nice, but Android 4.0, you could see more of the screen than you can when you're looking at this Android 5.0 view. Like, see the calendar app right there. You can only see about maybe a third of what's on the page of the calendar app. A quarter. You can only see a quarter, now that I actually see it, of the calendar app when it's open. Of course, now you can see more than that. But see how big the thumbnail is now that calendar app is on the front? But you cannot see that much of the apps in the back. And it seems like a lot more scrolling, too. Like, how many times do I have to scroll to get through all these apps? So yeah, not a huge deal. It's still pretty easy to use. You know, you can just swipe apps away to get them out of your memory. But yeah, just something where I found myself sort of missing for a little while the old Android 4.0 multitasking. I'm not sure what I can show you, really, what more I can show you on the software, because like I said, this is an LG software. But hopefully you can see how great this experience is. I've got my things here. This is all just spam, this top one, but this bottom one is not spam, so don't want to show you too much of my emails. But yeah, you can see how beautiful everything looks in Android 5.0. And it looks great on the screen. Like I said, looks wonderful, wonderful on the screen. And yeah, all in all, this is a great device. Let me go ahead and stop recording. But yeah, this is a really, really great phone. And why does that matter right now? Why does it matter that this is a great phone? Because it came out 2 years ago. Jacob, why do we care if a phone from 2 years ago is good? Are you just making this video because you're completely out of ideas for videos? Which, by the way, I totally am, and please leave a comment about what video I should make next. But no, the reason I'm telling you about the G2 now is because, first of all, I've used it for a year and a half. So I've been using it. If there was anything wrong with this phone, you know me. LG is not paying me for this video. And if you look at my other videos, I can be very, very critical of things that I do not like. If there was something wrong with this phone, I would be telling you about it and I would be emphasizing it, but there is honestly no downside about the phone itself. Like I said, there were a couple of quirks in Android 5.0 that I didn't like, but I'm using CyanogenMod. I'm using stock Android. I'm not even using LG's software that ships with this phone. So yeah, there is nothing specifically about this phone that I don't like. It is a great phone. You get 2-day battery life. You get decent cameras, even for today. You get a lot of horsepower. You get plenty of RAM. Fast processors, fast enough for Android. Plenty of storage, even though there's not expandable storage. It's plenty to start out with. If you are looking for a phone and you don't have $500 to spend on a phone, you don't have $800 to spend on a phone. You know, the iPhone is like 800 bucks. The newest iPhone is 800 bucks. You can get an older iPhone for a little cheaper. The G2, you can find new G2s like on Amazon for 200 bucks off contract. And I know a lot of people are starting to switch off of contracts. I got this phone on a contract. That's the only reason I was able to afford it, is I signed a 2-year contract with AT&T, or my parents did, because I'm not of a legal age to sign contracts right now. But yeah, people don't have $1,000 to spend on a device that fits in your pocket. It's just, you know, it's something that you use a lot and you depend on, but you might not be able to justify $500, $800. The new LG G4, $800 to get it off contract. $200 to get it on contract. You can get this off contract for $200. And then you can put a SIM card in it for whatever carrier you want. AT&T, T-Mobile, Ting. You can get the Verizon variant if you want this on Verizon. You can get it on Sprint. You can, you know, if you get a phone off contract, you can use it with whatever carrier you want. You have to make sure you've got the correct version. There's GSM and there's CDSA or whatever the other one is. But yeah, you should know, you know, I'm not here to tell you about why you should be getting a phone off contract, but let's say that you break your phone and it's going to cost more than $200 to fix it. Well, instead of paying $300 to fix your phone, you can pay $200 to get a G2. Or if you're looking for an upgrade, but you don't have a whole lot to spend, you're getting my drift. The reason why the G2 is such a great phone, aside from the beautiful hardware and the great software by the volunteers at CyanogenMod, it's a great phone because it's kept its value, and it would still be a wonderful phone to buy today. So if you're looking for an entry-level smartphone, stop looking for an entry-level smartphone. You can get an above-entry-level smartphone for an entry-level price. Go online, find yourself a new G2. It's 2 versions old. It is still, I would say, one of the best Android phones you can get. Definitely one of the top 5, and it certainly rivals the iPhone too. I highly recommend, if you get it, you put CyanogenMod on it. It just gives it that premium Nexus feel. If you have any questions about the device, I realize that I don't actually have a whole lot specifically to talk about. I kind of just summed up what the device is, what it looks like. But yeah, I'm telling you, it performs wonderfully. So if you have any questions about it, leave them in the comments below or at our website at nerdinthestreet.com. Also, like I said, if you have any ideas for videos, I would really appreciate those ideas. I'm thinking about doing a series on free and Libre software. Yeah, like Richard Stallman does. So if you want to watch that, then that's great. But if you want to watch something else, then let me know what I should talk about in the comments below. Thank you all for watching. We are almost to 1,000 subscribers on this channel. And so yeah, when 1,000 subscribers comes, there's going to be a special video. So stay tuned. But for now, I'm Jacob Kaufman. I'm Under the Street, and I will see you guys later. Bye.